Gildan Media presents an unabridged recording of A Team of Leaders, empowering every member to take ownership, demonstrate initiative, and deliver results, by Paul Gustavson and Stewart Liff. Narrated by Sean Pratt. Introduction. The Opportunity. How do you create an environment that successfully addresses the many challenges that supervisors and employees deal with while producing outstanding performance? The answer is simple. You have to create an environment where everyone is a leader. That is, an environment where everyone works together, takes the initiative, assumes ownership, is willing to deal with difficult issues, and accepts accountability for the team's results. An environment that is in stark contrast with one in which the supervisor tries to get everyone to produce. This is a fundamental change in the way that most work entities operate. However, as we will show you, such a workplace design will produce better performance and make your work life much more exciting, enjoyable, and fulfilling. You may think it sounds like a bunch of management buzzwords, concepts that are good in theory, but virtually impossible to implement in the real world. However, plenty of organizations have already redesigned their workplaces using the principles, tools, techniques, and strategies that we explain to you in this book. The challenge. If you're a supervisor or a team leader, you know how difficult it is to run a unit or team. You have constant pressure to perform, frequent demands on your time, problem employees to deal with, employees or unions with their own agendas. You get the picture. You have the one job where everyone seems to give you a hard time. Management demands improved performance. Employees want you to solve their problems. The union thinks you are treating its constituents unfairly. Other units need you to attend to their issues and, by the way, your wife or husband and children would like some of your time as well. In short, you feel that the weight of the world often rests on your shoulders, and you have few, if any, people to turn to for support. Deep down, you're probably saying to yourself, there has got to be a better way. As a team leader or team member, you most likely have stringent performance expectations and someone frequently looking over your shoulder. On top of that, you may feel these expectations are unrealistic and were simply imposed on you by higher-ups in management that don't understand or care what you are dealing with. You might also be feeling out of the loop and disengaged because you don't know what is really going on or what your true purpose is. Moreover, you may believe you are merely a cog in the wheel and easily replaceable based on the whims of your superiors. You may not like the way you are being treated and/or the way your team is being managed. For example, you may not be treated fairly, communication might be weak, and/or you may not receive the training you need. You may also feel you are not having the type of social connection with your coworkers that you would like to have. Alternatively, you may feel that you are a star and part of a team of stars who, like a high-powered racing car, can do much more if given the opportunity. You yearn for a way to contribute in a higher and more rewarding manner. For all the reasons stated and more, you and your coworkers may feel disenfranchised at work. The result is low morale, turned-off employees, and most important, poor performance. That is exactly why companies have invested millions, if not billions, of dollars in training, organizational, and team development. The challenges and problems just described, and which you are probably experiencing, are most likely caused by the traditional work structure. And that structure involves units or teams of people supervised by one individual who is over his head. To make matters worse, this structure is typically supported by a series of management systems and processes that are designed to maintain that relationship and, unintentionally, keep you and others from becoming a leader. In other words, most units or teams are designed not to produce leaders, which results in people thinking and acting simply as workers. Does this assessment apply to your situation? We suspect that it probably does. Before we go forward, we want to be clear that we are not saying it is impossible to have a successful team or unit using a traditional structure. Obviously, you can. What we are saying is that with, one, all the inherent challenges that currently exist in the workplace, and two, the expectation that things will only get more complicated, if you have a team of committed leaders, you are much more likely to have a high-performing team that will not be bogged down with all the negative issues we previously described. Many organizations have tried to address these issues, at least to some extent, by converting to a team environment. Perhaps yours has. The degree to which this team-building effort has helped matters varies, of course, case by case. However, relatively few organizations have tried to build teams of leaders, believing it is unrealistic or too difficult to accomplish, or they simply don't know how to get there. As a result, the traditional supervisor-employee relationship remains largely intact, and the aforementioned challenges have only been addressed to a limited degree at best. Is there a model we can use to build a team of leaders? The one we recommend is the 5-stage team development model, which is the underlying foundation of this book. Our discussion of this model was influenced by the work of Carl A. Bramlett Jr. and Abe Raab. This model identifies the 5 distinct stages of team development. At stage 1, the way most units or teams work today, the team leader interacts with each team member one-on-one. The model goes on to describe how your team can evolve and grow in varying stages all the way up to stage 5. This is the stage where the team essentially manages itself. Everyone becomes a leader, and the supervisor's time is freed up to work in other areas that create more value. Imagine being the leader of a team that is at stage 5. Under this scenario, you can advise the team as needed, but spend most of your time working on higher, cross-functional, and outside issues. Many of the problems that you typically deal with would now be handled by the team itself, freeing you up to work at a broader level. Your relationship with the team would also be very different. Instead of being a traditional supervisor who manages people on a one-on-one basis, you would teach the team members how to handle these issues and be available to assist them as needed. Instead of being frequently bogged down and overwhelmed, you would now have the time to focus on the important issues that were often neglected. Perhaps most important, instead of pushing and cajoling a disparate group of individuals to work on the team's goals and objectives, you will be working with energetic and motivated individuals who are leaders in their own right, and who will only occasionally turn to you for help in order to take them to the next level. And they will not be a group of whiners or people looking after their own best interests. Instead, they will be a team of leaders, trying to push the envelope and striving for the best performance possible. Wouldn't that be a refreshing change? If you are a team member, imagine what it would be like to be part of a team of leaders at stage 5. You would be a valued member of a team that manages itself. Instead of having someone standing over you, cracking the whip, you would now be part of a cohesive team wherein everyone holds each other accountable. In lieu of having goals simply imposed on you, you would play an integral role in developing these goals and trying to achieve them. Instead of hoping that you get the training you need to do your job, you would be involved in developing a comprehensive training plan to both gather and disseminate critical job knowledge. Rather than wondering where you fit in the organization, what you contribute, and what your team's purpose is, you would know exactly where you fit, understand the value you contribute, and have a clear sense of purpose. You would also work within a framework that is clear and aligned, meaning you would receive messages that are both consistent and purposeful. Furthermore, you would work in a setting that provides a strong social network and offers you the camaraderie and support you crave. Finally, you would work in a physical environment that is both inspiring and informal and reinforces your connection to both the mission and the metrics. Wouldn't that be an amazing change from your current situation? Examples of teams that have succeeded at self-management. You're probably still wondering, is it possible after all? Can it work in the real world? Let's review two examples of organizations that converted to self-directed work teams using the five-stage model. As you're reviewing these examples, compare them with the way your unit or team operates. The General Electric plant in Durham, North Carolina, does final assembly for the GE90 and CF34 jet engines. A Fast Company article, Engines of Democracy, pointed out that the plant's real power lies in the way that work is performed. The plant has more than 300 employees, but only one boss, the plant manager. All of these employees report to the boss, meaning that for all intents and purposes, they have no supervisor. Self-directed teams build the jet engines, teams that decide how to manage the work, how to manage time off, how to improve systems and work processes, and how to deal with problem teammates. Pay is transparent. That is, everyone is aware of how much money others on the team make because employees are paid by their skill level, and that information is available to each employee. Teams don't maintain a typical assembly line. Instead, they own an engine from start to finish. Moreover, everyone's work varies on a daily basis, keeping the work interesting and resulting in a high degree of variety. The plant has no time clock, so team members can take care of their personal business when needed. Meanwhile, the plant manager, the only supervisor in the entire plant, sits in an open cubicle in the middle of the factory floor. As you might expect, everyone does not successfully fit into this environment, especially people who expect to take orders. That's because the plant was designed to be operated by teams of leaders. To put that into perspective, there's this comment from one of the team members at the time the Fast Company article was written. "I have 15 bosses. All of my teammates are my bosses." The people in the Durham plant are clearly engaged, have high energy, possess multiple skills, and are very motivated. In addition, they take tremendous pride in their team and the work they perform. More important, the plant's performance has continued to excel, and it's considered by many to be an industry leader. All of this did not occur simply by magic. Oh, and by the way, when the GE plant first started out on its transformation effort, the plant had 175 employees. Since then, the workforce has virtually doubled, and GE continues to invest in the plant. Does that sound like your current situation? Our second example pertains to government, a sector in which change is always difficult. Both of the authors worked together on this endeavor to transform one particular organization and its teams. The Department of Veterans Affairs regional offices are responsible for adjudicating claims for veterans' benefits. All told, the VA has 58 regional offices across the country, serving more than 24 million veterans. In 1986, Stu became the assistant director of the U.S. Department of Veteran Affairs New York Regional Office, known as NIRO. At the time, all regional offices processed claims for benefits using an assembly line approach, resulting in many errors, a large amount of rework, and no one really owning the claim. Moreover, teamwork was rarely emphasized, since there were many specialized jobs and employees were only measured on how well they handled their small piece of the process. From the perspective of veterans, the claims took much too long to process. They still do, as VA has been overwhelmed with hundreds of thousands of claims from veterans returning from Iraq and Afghanistan. But veterans voiced other complaints as well. For example, they found it extremely difficult to find out the status of their claims, and they did not have a central point of contact. Naturally, this situation led to a high degree of frustration and low customer satisfaction. In 1991, a new director, Joe Thompson, arrived. He felt that the system was archaic, and there had to be a better way to process claims, serve veterans, and manage the employees. Working closely with OPD, Paul's company, Thompson, along with Stu and the NIRO staff, transformed the office from a unit-based operation to a team-based environment. Supervisors were replaced with or became coaches, and the team members received an enormous amount of technical training, as well as training on how to operate as a self-managed team. The assembly line process was replaced with each team owning the claims under its jurisdiction, resulting in fewer handoffs, more knowledgeable and better developed employees, and veterans having one point of contact. Service was measured using a balanced scorecard, which meant productivity, timeliness, and quality weren't looked at in a vacuum any longer. Along these lines, this information was posted and shared with the employees. All processes were reviewed. For example, the way people were interviewed, the manner in which performance was reviewed and managed, the way people were paid, and changes were made where appropriate. The NIRO even built a museum of veterans' benefits on site in order for employees to connect more closely to the mission. Eventually, people began to think and act differently as they evolved from being merely workers to becoming leaders. As word spread of this transformation effort, many public and private sector organizations came to learn from the NIRO's experience. Eventually, its success resulted in the NIRO receiving the first Hammer Award for reinventing government from then Vice President Al Gore. Stu and many of his teammates remember this as perhaps the most magical time of their careers. People came to work excited, feeling they had been elevated, had a higher sense of purpose, and were doing something special. They worked together in a way that is rarely seen in a work setting, particularly government. Today, roughly 20 years after that transformation effort, many of the members of the senior team keep in touch and consider each other to be lifelong friends. Wouldn't you like to feel that way about your team? Now what? Since most problems are caused by the way teams and their management systems and processes are designed, in order to address the problems once and for all, teams need to change their design. For example, if your team is designed to operate under a supervisor who is all-knowing and all-controlling, you will react accordingly. That is, you will probably over-rely on your supervisor, be afraid to exercise independent judgment, not show much initiative, and be merely a follower. If little information is shared, you will not know what value you contribute or understand the effect of your actions, in which case the unintended consequences are going to be low productivity and/or downstream errors. Meanwhile, the supervisor will have to frequently work to the point of exhaustion, since she will be trying to control the work of a group of compliant, but not committed, employees, which is a formula for mediocrity at best. The point here is that you get what you design for. If you want to have a team of leaders, you must design and align all your systems and processes to make that happen. Since it probably took your team or unit a number of years to get to where it is today, expect that it will take some time, perhaps even years, before your team can become a Stage 5 team. A good analogy here is weight control. Just as it takes time to gain weight, it also takes time to lose it. Moreover, unless the requisite support systems are in place, for example, exercise, eating right, a calorie counter if necessary, you are unlikely to keep the weight off in the long run. The same concept holds true for taking your team to Stage 5. It takes time to get there, and your transformation will only last if the necessary systems and processes are in place. However, the results will definitely make your investment of time and energy worthwhile. So, a core principle of this book is that you should design your team for the results you want. The rest of this book will show you how to do just that. Chapter 1, Creating Advantage Through the 5-Stage Team Development Model. Key Principle: Leadership always exists in a team. However, everyone becomes a leader once a team achieves Stage 5 of the 5-Stage Team Development Model. Think of your current team or work unit. Is it self-managing? How involved and committed are your team members? How well do you all work together? How many people act as leaders? How much knowledge is shared? Most important, how well is your team or unit performing? If you're using a traditional supervisor-employee model, we strongly suspect that your answers to most, if not all, of these questions will be lukewarm at best. Our experience and research has shown that the highest performing teams exhibit more self-sufficiency, that is, self-management, and are more engaged than leader-focused teams. This makes perfect sense because self-managing teams have a greater sense of ownership and employee involvement and often produce better results. While many of the same principles, strategies, tactics, tools, and frameworks generally apply to all types of teams, only well-developed, self-managing teams produce teams of leaders. If your team is not self-managing and is not producing the results you would like, then this is the time to explore a proven, alternative approach. Self-managed work teams. A self-managed team is a team of employees working on their own toward a common goal, whose members identify, plan, and manage their daily activities and work under very limited or no supervision. As the team develops, the members do too, with one of the key objectives being to transform each employee into a committed, highly engaged, flexible, and well-rounded leader. High-performing, self-managed teams retain much greater accountability for their work. Because they often are cross-trained, they are better at problem-solving and more flexible in meeting scheduling requirements. In general, multifunctional teams control variances in the process better than functional silos, because they are more aware of the downstream effects of their mistakes. To become self-managing, each of your team's members must learn how to accomplish many new tasks, such as planning, scheduling, and performance feedback, tasks that are traditionally performed by supervisors. It's not an easy thing to do. In fact, a common mistake organizations make is to expect work teams to become high-performing right away. Rather, self-managed teams evolve over a period of months, or more often, years. So don't be surprised if a temporary drop in productivity or morale first precedes the benefits you reap from becoming such a team, as people struggle to change. This book is important because it will explain why the transition is often difficult. At the same time, we'll show you how to make the journey as effective and painless as possible. Once your team truly becomes self-managing, you can expect to deliver improved performance. Moreover, individual results within your team will also get better because people will find the challenge of learning new kinds of management tasks to be very rewarding. Finally, as each team member's role evolves, and as your team members become more engaged, possess wider and deeper skills, and start being proactive, they will change from being merely doers to becoming energetic leaders. The Team Development Model. To accomplish the ambitious goals described, we will focus on one of the real breakthrough tools used by teams to separate themselves from the pack. This framework and tool, influenced by the work of Carl A. Bramlett Jr. and Abe Robb, was discovered when trying to facilitate the natural propensity and desire of team members to move toward building increased capability and self-management. The 5-stage team development model allows self-managed teams to develop over time vis-a-vis their relationship with their leader. As teams become more independent, team leaders in turn are freed up to do more development and analysis work. Understanding this development process will make your transition to self-managing teams much smoother. A successful self-managed team generally evolves through a series of discernible stages. At the first stage, your team will start off with virtually every key decision being made by the supervisor or team leader. Because the transition to self-management is going to require a lot of change, the team needs an enormous amount of support. Some of the initial enthusiasm often gives way to sarcasm, as things will not go as smoothly as many people expect. This is why the team leader must be more involved than ever, to ensure that people understand how teams evolve, to address areas of uncertainty, and to deal with issues that the team is not capable of handling. Slowly, your team will become less leader-focused. As the team moves to stage 2, it will start to grapple with what its goals and objectives are, and try to ensure that everyone is on the same page. Again, this transition usually doesn't happen as quickly as many would like. The team leader will still have to do a lot of coordinating and mentoring as the team begins to take baby steps while the leader begins to gradually move away from exercising full authority. Stage 3 is the midway point in your team's evolution. While there still may be some frustration, members will start to learn their roles and come together. The big picture starts to become clearer to the team and its members. And a few individuals will even step up and provide some limited but real leadership. Moreover, the team will start to focus on performance. At the same time, this is also the stage where your team will start to deal with difficult people issues. The supervisor will still be intimately involved in helping to resolve these challenges because team members usually don't know what to do and are uncomfortable with conflict. Interestingly, dealing with difficult people is something that most supervisors are not usually comfortable with either. At stage 4, your team will really start to hum. Most of the team members are able to step up and lead in at least one specific area. People will communicate quite well and learn from each other. They will also take a serious interest in performance and try and actively achieve many of their goals and objectives. In addition, the level of engagement will clearly rise, and the team will look to take charge of all its key processes and procedures. By the same token, there will still be work to do, particularly in the areas of problem-solving and conflict resolution, two areas that teams generally take longer to become proficient in. You must also continue to work on ensuring that all the team members have the requisite skill sets. At this stage, the supervisor will now be more of a coach and be on a more equal footing with the other team members, and the primary focus becomes training and developing the team members. He will have time to begin to focus on higher order work and contributions. Once your team reaches stage 5, it will be at the highest level where the team is self-managing. You will now work together as a unit to set and achieve a challenging set of goals and objectives. Everyone will be involved in team management and in grabbing the bull by the horns in order to get the job done. More important, individual team members will no longer be followers. They will be leaders who look down the road and at their environment in order to get and stay ahead of the curve. Meanwhile, good performance would no longer be acceptable to your team members. They will only accept excellent performance and beyond. Finally, the energy level of the team will be extremely high, as its members will know what they need to do, will be committed to doing it, and will work together to provide the best performance possible. All of this change will allow you, as team leader, to focus on other things besides team performance. Now the leader becomes more of a peripheral member of the team and is free to work on larger issues such as analysis, planning, and cross-functional concerns. In a moment, I'll describe the 5-stage team development model, how everyone becomes a leader. It will depict 1. The changing roles of the team members and the leader, and 2. How everyone becomes a leader. The 5-stage team development model. Stage 1. Being directive. Team members' role. Receives assignments and follows orders. Team leader's role. Traditional. Makes assignments one-on-one with each member of the team. Stage 2. Journey starts. Team members' role. Employees begin to interact with each other and start to learn new team processes. Team leader's role. Supervisor begins to coach the team, that is, begins to develop the team and the team members. Stage 3. Progress. Team members' role. Leadership begins to be shared. A few team members step up and provide leadership on tasks and assignments. Codifiable knowledge sharing is increasing. The team is starting to see the bigger picture. Team leader's role. Supervisor identifies areas where team members can step up and take on leadership responsibilities and coaches those who desire to successfully step up on these leadership activities. Continues to lead on most of the leadership activities while accelerating learning and the transfer of responsibilities. Stage 4. Almost there. Team members' role. Leadership is shared. Most team members are stepping up and taking responsibility for the majority of the leadership activities. Many beginning to focus on increasing the value of their own and their team's contribution. Some tacit knowledge is being shared. Team leader's role. Team leader has delegated the majority of leadership activities that the team members can handle and plays the role of counselor and coach to those who have stepped up. The team leader also becomes involved in the high-value work outside the team and begins transitioning difficult people issues to the team. And finally, stage 5, everyone a leader. Team members' role. Everyone on the team steps up and provides leadership so that all the leadership tasks are led by the team members. Many team members can lead multiple activities and are leaders on all issues. They are pushing their performance to the next level. Codifiable and tacit knowledge equally shared. Long-term planning is being done. Outstanding performance is the result. Team leader's role. The leader becomes advisor to the team as team members take their performance to the next level. Remains the person to whom the team reports on its accountabilities. The team leader's greatest contribution comes from being involved with higher-level work, such as looking outward, special projects, cross-functional teams, etc., and managing multiple teams. As you can clearly see, at stage 5, where everyone is a leader, the roles are strikingly different. People are no longer workers. They are all actively involved in every aspect of the team's operation. Wouldn't you want to be part of a team where everyone is this involved and committed? And where the supervisor actually has time to both scan the environment and look down the road? To make things even clearer, I'll now go into detail with the Guide to the 5-Stage Team Development Model. This guide is here to help you better understand the way.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.